last time I talked about overcoming, and well, that was only last week, actually. I talked about they overcame, you know, from the book of, that's from the book of Revelations, chapter 12, verse 9 and 10. Says, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And we spoke about the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And we said that the blood of the Lamb represents what God has done, okay, to overcome the devil on our behalf in the sacrificial blood of the Lamb. And then we spoke about the word of the testimony, which is what is required of us, what we have done, our response to the work of God. And we spoke about the testimony of a relationship. We spoke about the testimony of obedience. We spoke about the testimony of service. And we spoke about the testimony of giving. All right? And that is the testimony. That is what you are required to do, what God requires of you, you know. Because God does not, just like any investor, you don't invest something, you don't invest money and not expect anything. You don't plant seed on your farm and not expect a harvest. That is just not real. So God is like that in our lives. He has deposited something in us and he expects a return. He expects us to be good stewards. This morning I'm going to preach about service. Remember we spoke about the four testimonies. The testimony of a relationship, the testimony of obedience, the testimony of service. This morning I want to focus on service. Amen. So we're going to read Romans chapter 12, verse 1. All right. In fact, we're going to go through the whole chapter, but as text, we're going to start with Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Okay. Now, there's only one place I beg to differ with the NIV where it says this is your true and proper worship. Most versions I read, they say this is your act of service. This is your spiritual service, your reasonable service. So it's all about service, okay? Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing, or holy and acceptable to God. This is your true and proper worship, or this is your reasonable service, or this is your spiritual service. Can we all say service? Service. Yes. It's all about service, all right? Paul, if you look at most of his letters, he speaks about our position in God. He speaks about what God has done. And he makes sure that it's clear that our position in God cannot change. What God has done cannot be altered. But then he goes on. If you look at most of his letters, in almost the final chapters, he talks about how we should respond to what God has done. How we should walk in love, how we should walk in grace, how we should walk in faith. It's all about the walk. And most of it is about service. Serving God. Okay. So he says, present your bodies, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies. First of all, it starts with the body. Okay? It starts with the body. There is a reason why the Bible uses the body, says the body. There's a reason why the Holy Spirit says, present your body as a living sacrifice. It doesn't say present your heart. It doesn't say present your devotion. It doesn't say present your spirit. It says present your. Can you say it loud? Present your. Okay. Raise your hand if you've got a body. I don't care how it looks. I don't care how it's. If you have a body, you qualify to be used of God. Hallelujah. Because it says, present your bodies as a living sacrifice. Okay. So it starts with the body. Okay. And Philippa says, well, that means availability, which is true. A body which is available is usable by God. Now, are there believers, I'm going to ask, are there believers who do not have bodies? Do you know of any believer who does not have a body? There's none. So which means every believer who has a body has to present their body as a living sacrifice. Is that true? Yes. So the call to serve is for everyone. It's not for a select few. It's not for some people. Okay? It's for everyone. So, present your body. In one part of Scripture, Jesus Christ said, sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but you have given me a body. I find that passage of Scripture. You have given me a body. Which means for Christ to function on earth, he had to have a body. And for him to serve on earth, he had to have a body. Is the body that serves. Hallelujah. Yes. You see, sometimes we Christians over-spiritualize things. It's my heart. It's all about my heart. You don't know what's in my heart. Don't judge me. It's all about my heart. But the Bible says, present your body. So if your body is not there, you are not there. I don't care what your heart posture is like. I don't care what you have in your heart, what you feel in your heart. If your body is not there, you are not there. All right. It's just the truth. He says it's a living sacrifice. And I like what Daniel was saying here, that do not hold anything back. Did you hear what Danny said when worship was starting? You know, he says, as a living sacrifice. You know, a sacrifice, when they sacrificed an animal, they sacrificed everything. Do you know that? Whenever they sacrificed an animal, they sacrificed every part of that animal. There was nothing that was held back. Everything was sacrificed. So he says, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable before God, which is your reasonable act of service. So when you present yourself, you're not going to hold anything back. Serving is serious business. You do not hold anything back. Because you are not your own. You were bought with a price. Hallelujah. Yes. And the reason why we are still here on earth, okay, as the church, as the bride, is to serve. Like it or not, it's to serve. So all this is the objective of service, okay? The reason why we serve is so that we present ourselves as a living sacrifice to God, holy and acceptable, which means to God it's an holy and acceptable sacrifice. It's something that he loves. It's a pleasing aroma to God. Now let's go to the attitude of service. Okay? Can we read verse 2 of Romans chapter 12? Now, serving is all about attitude. when they train soldiers, okay, most of the training is not how to shoot a rifle. How many of you know that? Most of the training is about discipline. Most of the training is about how to make you usable, how to make you respond to commands, how to make you say, yes, sir. Do you know it's not easy to say, yes, sir? So many things have to be stripped off you for you to say, yes, sir. For you to be usable, for you to advance when the call says, let's advance. For you to respond when the call says, let's engage the enemy. Because if you do not have the teaching and the discipline inside of you, you are going to be thinking about yourself. And Danny spoke about Esau. He did not have that discipline. All he thought about was his hunger. All he thought was himself, about was himself. What is going to happen to me if I don't have this soup? I will die of hunger. But what about the inheritance? What about what God has done? What about what God has promised? But all he thought was just about himself. And many believers are like that. All we were taught to think about ourselves. And part of it comes from the culture, the individualistic culture that is in us. Andrew talked about the unholy trinity, me, myself, and I. We were taught to think about ourselves. That is where the problem is. So, the attitude of service is even more important than serving itself. Because if you do not have the right attitude, you are not usable. You cannot be used. It says, do not conform to the pattern of this world. The pattern of this world is about myself. It doesn't make sense to sacrifice myself according to the pattern of this world. Amen. It doesn't make sense for me to die for the sake of others. It doesn't make sense in the world. What makes sense in the world is for others to die for my sake. For others to lack for my sake. For others to be poor for my sake so that I become rich. But the Bible says of Christ, he became rich. He became poor so that we'll become rich. Do you see how the kingdom principles are a reverse of the world's principles? Do not conform to the pattern of this world. The world has got a pattern. The world has got a way in which it does things. And it's so easy to, I can use the word, Christianize the pattern of this world. It's so easy to use, to paint the pattern of this world with biblical language and say we are serving God when we are serving ourselves and our own interests. It says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So which means you need a new, totally new mindset, which is not of the world. A mind of Christ. Hallelujah. He says, so that you, then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, which means you can, then you can say, yes, sir. Hallelujah. When he speaks, then you can say, yes, sir. Speak, my Lord. Speak, my Lord. Where you send me, I'll go. If you are conformed to the pattern of this world, whenever God speaks, you're not going to say, yes, sir. You're going to say, no, sir. But when your inner worldly voice speaks, then you're going to say, yes, sir, to that voice. Raise a hallelujah. Very few hallelujahs raised this morning. But anyway, I will speak. Do not conform to the pattern of this world. Now, I want us to go to the book of Philippians. Philippians 2. Okay, before we go to Philippians, let's go to verse 3 of Romans chapter 12. Sorry, let's go to verse 3 of Romans chapter 12. Paul is trying to explain how not to conform to the pattern of this world, okay? He doesn't just say, you know, most of us are guilty of just taking one verse and then running with that verse without bothering to read what it follows after. He doesn't just say, don't conform to the pattern of this world and then leave you there. No, he explains exactly what he means by that. He says, by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, every one of you here, he says, do not think yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. You know, he says, do not have a high regard of yourself. You know, what the Holy Spirit does is to diminish self, this thing called self, because this is what is counterproductive to the kingdom. Hallelujah. Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought. Don't put yourself there. Don't put yourself first. But think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each one of you. All right? Now let's go to the book of Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 8. We're trying to see how this mindset is cultivated of being usable by God. We are talking about the attitude of service. Okay? He says, in your relationship with one another, have the same mindset. This version actually says mindset. My version says mind. Mindset as Jesus Christ. And what was the mindset of Jesus Christ? Who, being in very nature God, okay, by nature Jesus Christ was God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Okay? Do you see this mindset? Though he was by nature God, he did not consider equality with God as something to be used to his own advantage. But what did he do? Rather, he made himself nothing. He made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, Christ becoming the very virtue of Christ becoming man was actually turning himself into nothing. Because look at God who is worshipped in heaven, becoming man. So we are told to have this nature, this mindset that Christ Jesus had, that he did not think of himself highly. But he became nothing for the sake of serving God, for the sake of being obedient to God. That's the attitude of serving. I just felt in my heart, before we go into how to serve, we've got to know the attitude of serving. It's not so that I make a name for myself. It's not so that I become known. Hallelujah. It's so that God uses me and places me in a place where I can say, yes, sir, to whatever he wants me to do. When he says jump, I can say, how high? I do not think of myself highly. I have the mindset which Christ had. That is why every day you read about this church and that church. This church, there's a split. There are wrangles, there are fights, and most of the time, people are fighting for positions. People are fighting to be recognized. It's like this verse has just been removed and torn from the Bible. People are having a high regard for themselves, more than the regard, the desire to serve, but they have a high desire to be served. A desire to be noticed, a desire to be honored. But we are told to have the same mindset that Christ had. Hallelujah. That's the mind that we are supposed to have. And it says he humbled himself even to the point of death, even the death of a criminal, the death on the cross. Can we go to the book of Acts 10, chapter 38? How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. You know, so this is how he used the anointing. He went about doing good. So we say that to serve, you need a body. And when God has called you, use that body and go around doing good. Hallelujah. You don't just sit. But does it say he sat down when he was anointed? Does it say that he used this anointing to create a Facebook page and then generate likes so that people know that he's the anointed one of God? No, he went about doing good. He went about serving, healing, delivering people that were oppressed. Hallelujah. Let's go to John 5, chapter 36. We're using Christ as an example. You see, Christ is our ultimate example of the life of faith. He says, I have testimony weightier than that of John. For the works that the Father has given me to finish, the very works that I'm doing testify that the Father has sent me. Do you see this? The very works. He didn't say, oh, it's because I'm the Son of God. He says, the works that I do testify that the Father has sent me. Okay, there is a hyper grace doctrine which is not correct, which just says you are saved by faith. Faith and faith alone. Faith and faith alone. Okay? But Jesus Christ says, the works that I do. And we are told by James that faith without works is. Faith without works is. Yes. So the faith of Jesus Christ was not dead. He says, the works that I do. The works that I do, and works should be seen by people. Because it's a body that is doing the works in response to what God has done. He says, the works that I do testify that the Father has sent me. Another example is David. Let's go to the book of Acts, chapter 18, verse 36. Acts, chapter 18, verse 36. It says, and now when David had served God's purpose to his own generation, he fell asleep. He was buried with his ancestors, and his body decayed. When David had served God's purpose, hallelujah, you were created to serve. You were born to serve. Okay. Now let's go to the works of service. Okay. I'm just going to read from quickly, all right? I'm reading Romans 12, okay? And I'm going to read from verse 4. We've done verse 1, verse 2, verse 3, which says that do not think of yourself highly, more highly than you ought to. Okay. For it says, for as we have many, for as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function. So this is a body, okay? Understand that this is a body, and each part of the body has got to function. Do you understand? Each part of the body has to function. There is no part of the body that was put there to do nothing. And if you ask any doctor or biologist, they will tell you that every part of the body has got a function and a purpose. Okay? For we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function. Okay? Always remember that. Not everyone is going to be Reinhard Bonnke, the mighty evangelist who's known all over the world. Okay? But there are some people who will be like that. But all the members of the body do not have the same function. So we being many are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given us. So our gifts are different, but according to the grace that is given us. All right? Let us use them. I love this. Let us use them. Let us use our gifts. Can you turn to someone and say, use your gift? Can you say, use your gift? Because the Bible says, let us use them. It wasn't Munya who said this. It's the Bible that says, the gifts that you have been given, use them. Don't sit on them. Don't use them for decoration. It says, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy. I was disappointed that no one prophesied over young Simon here. But we were doing a prophetic activation just a couple of weeks ago. Surely someone has got to prophesy to young Simon after the service. Because God has given some of us that gift. It's impossible to have a church without a single person with a gift of prophecy. That is impossible. Otherwise, this would not have been mentioned in Scripture. Okay. Let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. Or ministry. Let us use it in our ministering. He who teaches in teaching. And here he is using an example of a ministry gift, like a teaching. They are pastors, they are apostles, they are evangelists. Okay? There are some people that have got ministry gifts. They are supposed to be used. He who exhausts in exhortation, he who gives with liberality, okay? He who leads with diligence. You must lead with diligence. He who shows mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil. Cling to what is good. Love should be sincere, all right? There's no more fake love. There's this song that they used to sing. No more fake love, I want true love, baby. God is looking for true love. You cannot serve people effectively if you do not have true love. The Bible says, let love be sincere. Okay? Abhor what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be kindly affectionate, that's verse 10, one to another, with brotherly love, in honor, giving preference to one another. So the kingdom is not a me first, but give preference one to another, and it's a kingdom of honor. Not lagging in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Not lagging in diligence, that's verse 11. Serving is hard work, okay? It's hard work. Serving is work. And as I said last time, sometimes you have to go to see someone. Sometimes you have to call someone to your house. Sometimes you have to go to someone else's workplace. Sometimes you've got to respond when someone calls, when they're in trouble. Serving is not easy. It's not a walk in the park. That's why it involves discipline. It's hard work. I'm going to ask you a question. If the whole world were blind, if everyone, let's say everyone in this church were blind, would you wear the very clothes that you're wearing today? If you knew that everyone else here was blind, I mean, I want you to answer honestly. Would you take time to really look in the mirror and dress yourself? Okay, let's just assume that you came here in a tinted vehicle, okay, and you don't care. No one else can see you. And then you're here and everyone else here is blind. Would you be dressed the way you're dressed right now? Would you do your hair the way your hair is done right now? Think about it. Do we serve if no one is noticing? Are we faithful when there's no one to say well done? In your closet, in your own private space, how much do you think of serving other people? Think about it and be honest with yourself. And most of the time when you think about how much you really think about yourself. So many times I've had to repent and say, God, I am so sorry. All I thought about was myself. All I thought about was my interests, what's going to happen to me. But it's all about you. It's all about serving other people. It's all about serving the body. It's all about serving other believers. So prophecy should be according to faith. Okay, and I said we talk, there was a prophetic activation here to stir up the gifts that are in some people. Some people have more than one gift, all right? Which means you have more accountability if you've got more than one gift. Use your gift. Find your gift and use it. It says those who are give should give liberally. Do you know that we are all called to give, okay? All right, let me put it this way. Every Christian has got every gift to some extent. Do you know that? Every Christian has got every gift to some extent. But there are some people who are called, who have got the gift of prophecy, which means in them it's more distinct, okay? In them it's above normal. Every Christian is supposed to give, but there are some people who have got a gift. Their giving is above normal. It's above the 10% and above the tithe, and it's just above board because it's a gift. And it says that they that have got this gift should give with liberality. And there are some people who have got leadership gifts. Check yourself. What is your bent? What is your gift? Surely you've got to be doing something in the house. You've got to be serving the house of God. And it says, they that lead should lead with diligence. Mercy. Those are the gifts of mercy. That can practically, those that practically help people in a practical sense. There are some people who just help other people in a practical sense. Okay? I still remember when we lived in Waterfalls, and There was a time when everything in our house was broken down. And then there was this man, he was a deacon. He just said, I've come to pay you a visit. And, you know, we entertained him. And then he said, he had his toolbox. And he said, is there anything broken in your house? I said, well, this is broken, that is broken, this is broken. And by the time he left, he had fixed everything. That's serving. Amen. He didn't preach to me. In as much as preaching to me is good, he didn't pray for me. In as much as praying for me is good, but he gave of what he was gifted in. And I was blessed, actually blessed because of that. So he says, in mercy, those with the gift of mercy should do so with cheerfulness. Okay, they shouldn't be grumbling, why do I have to fix their TV? Can't they fix it by themselves? No. He was so cheerful when he did it, and he was so happy. He was actually happier that he had served me than I was happy about being served. That's how serving should be. It should also give you joy. You should have joy in serving, joy in solving people's problems, joy in meeting people's needs, joy in visiting someone who's in hospital. Hallelujah. Or someone in prison. I say, hey, why are you in prison? No, the Bible says, I was in prison and you visited me. So it should be with cheerfulness, and love should be sincere.